Welcome to Four Corners. For the past 18 months of the coronial inquest into the Lindt Cafe tragedy, the hostages and families of the victims have relived the heartache and horror of the siege. In 2 days, the New South Wales coroner will hand down his findings into the events at Sydney's Martin Place in December 2014. The inquest spent a great deal of time trying to unravel the motivations of terrorist Man Haron Monis, a deluded and troubled individual, and how it was that a man charged with accessory to murder and sexual assault could have been out on bail. But the core task of the inquest was to investigate the deaths of the two uniquely gifted citizens who lost their lives that day. Evidence drawn out at the inquest presents a picture of multiple systems failures, failures of procedure, and of common sense. Over the next 2 weeks, Four Corners will examine that evidence in detail. And for the first time, the families of Tori Johnson and Katrina Dawson speak publicly about the failures they believe led to the deaths of their loved ones. Part one of this two-part special investigation begins on the morning of the siege.
About 9:44 this morning, at least one gunman, possibly two, walked into the Lindt chocolate shop in Martin Place.
Oh, it was dreadful. We drove down the M1, very crazy drive, and I was trying to get onto Thomas on the way down. I was sure that he probably hadn't heard because he was so busy with work at that time.
I took Rosie's call and she asked me, are you at work? I said, yes, I'm at work. And she said, is Tori at work? I said, yes, she's at work today. What's wrong? And she said, have you heard what's happening at Lindt?
He said, right, I'll find out what I can and see you down there.
Sydney was gearing up for Christmas, but the festive mood was suddenly transformed. Let it snow, let it snow, let it
snow. So we'll keep you updated with this, but it is a developing story. We have a hostage situation inside a cafe in Martin Place.
I got a call from my assistant, Erica. She was all agitated, letting me know that there'd been the situation in Martin Place where there was a gunman. So I tried to call Katrina and I couldn't get through. I sent her a text. It's like, there's a gunman in the Lindt Cafe. I hope you're not there. Let me know.
Absolutely chilling shots of hostages and obviously being told to stay in that position, hands up against the glass for all to see.
I went straight to the closest TV and saw it all over the news.
As the manager of the Lindt Cafe, 34-year-old Tori Johnson was bound to be caught up in the siege. His family knew he'd feel protective of everyone there.
He just made you feel like you were the only one in the world when you were with him. He was able to convey that just by the way, you know, he looked at you.
Thomas Zinn had been Tori's partner for 14 years.
I knew from the point in time that I got into the taxi that Tori was in great danger. I was immediately, obviously, very agitated, scared, in various stages between in tears and have deep thoughts on what am I going to do and what is happening.
We started to get a lot of texts from friends saying, you know, is Katrina there?
38-year-old Katrina Dawson was a brilliant young barrister from a nearby chambers. She was also a wife to Paul and mother of three children.
She was a wonderful mother. There was always a great sense of fun, and her brothers were very protective of her. she and I were blessed in having a really wonderful relationship.
Paul was frantically trying to work out if she was there or not, and he knew that that was a regular haunt.
Katrina was in the cafe. One of the hostages made to hold up a flag at the window.
I just didn't know what to do. I got in a taxi and was in the taxi frantically on the phone, and I remember asking the driver to keep the radio on. And in the end, I decided to go around the city and went to my parents' apartment, which is in Potts Point, and got out there. And I remember the taxi driver saying, "Hey, I hope everything works out."
In the morning rush hour, CCTV cameras caught a figure with a baseball cap and backpack striding through Martin Place. The author and the embodiment of the nightmare to come. But when he entered the Lindt Cafe, Manharon Moniz presented at first as an ordinary customer. Then he asked to see the manager.
I just thought that perhaps the man was complaining, but I didn't get that immediate assessment because he was smiling. Moniz was smiling and nodding his head.
When Tori called me over to come and speak to me, and he was sitting down with Moniz, and he looked visibly scared, and he asked me to go and lock the doors of the cafe.
19-year-old waiter Jared Morton Hoffman went to the doors. Oblivious to the unfolding drama, an office worker crossed the foyer as Tori was forced at gunpoint to make a call to 000.
Thank you, police emergency, Splendor.
This is a message that I'm reading from someone who's standing in front of me. There's bombs in three locations.
Okay.
I need to finish reading this message.
Yes, I understand that. Just take a minute.
Sorry, I have a gun in front of me.
Okay.
Australia is under attack by Islamic State. There are three bombs in three different locations. Martin Place, Circular Quay and George Street. Police should not come close to me or other brothers, otherwise they will explode the bombs. Some hostages have been taken.
All right, well, you just need to hang on a second. From Little Ink Chocolate Shop, is it?
That's right.
All right, just stay with me on the line, please.
He basically said that he had a bomb and that he had fellow brothers who had bombs across the city. And the reason for the attack was our involvement in Syria and Iraq, like our military involvement in Syria and Iraq against ISIS.
City car, thanks. Any car that can make their way, please. Above Martin Place, Phillip Street, because of Elizabeth Street at Sydney. Informant is currently being held at gunpoint.
In the cafe foyer, the first policeman on the scene crept towards the doors. Office staff emerged from the lifts, still unaware of the crisis, as the officer radioed in what he could see.
Traffic 389, urgent.
389.
Radio, I've got two female staff members with their hands up at the door. Both of them very visibly distressed. I can't see any further around.
We understand where those police are. That's on the corner of Elizabeth Street and Martin Place.
Guns have been drawn. If you can see the police officer with the pale lilac shirt, he has his gun drawn.
The first policeman into the foyer was ordered to pull out, but one observation he made had serious consequences. He reported seeing a curled wire coming out of Moniz's backpack. The mistaken belief that Moniz was carrying a bomb would shape police command decisions for the whole day.
Oh, didn't know what was going to happen, did I? Didn't know if he was going to gun each of us down one by one, or just that not knowing what was going to happen. Pretty scary.
There were 18 hostages inside the cafe. Katrina Dawson was there with two close friends, Stefan Balafoutis and Julie Taylor.
I knew Julie was pregnant. We were concerned, or I was concerned, that this whole trauma might have a deleterious effect on her health and the baby's health. And I'm sure Katrina would have felt the same.
During the early confusion, Monis seemed willing to let the two women leave.
He says, yes, you can go. And she and Julie are virtually out the door. And Katrina says, what about him, meaning Stefan, their friend? And then just suddenly all changed.
She even collected her bag. She had her black bag. I think it was Katrina or Julie, but Moni said, stop and stand there. And that's how we were positioned slowly into our spots.
He told me to go in the center of the window, and I deliberately stayed off center, trying to, doing so, thinking the police could have a better view inside. And he came up behind me, grabbed me by the collar, and I felt the gun at the back of my head.
What did you think when you had the gun in your back?
Yeah, I was scared. Because it turns physical at that point. I think the fear turns very real. And you think you are, yeah, you're just a moment away from dying.
The city around Martin Place was evacuated. At this time, Mick Fuller, now New South Wales Police Commissioner, was in command. Bomb squads were dispatched to the locations named by Monis. Police snipers and members of the police tactical unit were positioned around the cafe, now called the Stronghold.
This is a scene that we hoped would never come to Sydney. Our beautiful city under siege on this Monday morning.
The terrorism threat level in Australia had been raised to high in September.
I believe I immediately thought it was a terrorist attack because beforehand there was the news about someone's going to be beheaded in Martin Place and I work in Martin Place.
At 11:15 a.m, Police Commissioner Andrew Scipione and Head of Counter-Terrorism Kath Byrne declared the siege a terrorist event. Specially trained counter-terrorism officers took over the running of the siege. Assistant Commissioner Mark Murdoch replaced Fuller as commander. Police had already requested the Army's elite counter-terrorism unit be put on standby. The Tactical Assault Group, or TAG, was set up for armed intervention and hostage recovery in domestic terrorism events. Highly trained combat veterans created a mock Lindt Cafe at their barracks on the edge of Sydney and immediately began rehearsing an armed entry to rescue the hostages. The Defence Force sent liaison officers to police command who remained throughout the siege, but the tactical assault group was never called to Martin Place.
I'm watching vision live now of heavily armed tactical response officers with body armour on, high-powered weapons at their disposal.
Tactical police handle hundreds of high-risk incidents a year, but rarely use their weapons. Police strategy for these events is to contain and negotiate rather than to go in.
The police near the door, I could hear them talking the whole time. Couldn't hear exactly what they were talking, but I knew there was a group there.
Just before 12:30, the proximity of the officers around the cafe triggered a crisis inside. Monis ordered Jared to ring the police.
Thank you, police emergency. This is Alison.
I'm currently a hostage in Lindt Place. Can you please tell all police officers to move away immediately?
So you're in the Lindt building, are you?
Yes, I am right now. He's going to shoot someone right now. Can you please tell them to please tell them to go away?
There was a couple of police officers that had come quite close to one of the windows near the kitchen of the cafe. So one of them had like one of those metal riot shields, and then Monis had gone and seen them and then freaked out.
He's telling the police officers to move away right now.
Okay.
That's what they're doing right now.
Yeah. Okay, this, I'm talking to the police at the moment.
Please, please, very quickly. He's 2 minutes or he's shooting someone. He has a gun pointed at someone right now.
I was scared, like, you know, no one wants to get shot. But at the same time, I was apprehensive about, like, I don't want to make any mistakes. I want to make sure that this has the right outcome for everyone. And so I can't screw this call up.
I remember Monis holding me and being really convinced that this was going to be it for me.
Who's he talking to?
He's talking to me right now. He's saying if the police go away right now, he's not going to shoot the lady in front of me. There's a policeman at the window who has not moved. Mm. Can you please tell him?
Yeah, okay. I am, okay. Is he holding the gun to her head?
Yes.
Monis got his way. The tactical police were moved back.
He called all the hostages around him to create like a human shield. He kind of went closer into the corner. So he kind of walked back into that corner, had all the hostages pressed up in front of him with his gun raised at our backs.
Monis and the hostages expected police to storm the cafe in a rescue mission. But the police had decided to go in only in response to an emergency. Early on, that meant if Monis fired his gun at the hostages. But during the course of the siege, the trigger was fixed at a much higher level. Police would only go in when a hostage was killed or seriously injured.
The idea that we had to wait for somebody to be killed or seriously injured before the police would act was staggering.
The first time I heard that evidence, I was sitting calmly in the courtroom. And inside, my head was exploding with, that can't possibly be the case. You know, that just, there's, really? You know, there's no explanation that I can make that can fully express how shocking that news was to me.
It's outrageous. It's outrageous. That these are people that they should be protecting. They shouldn't wait for them to be impacted on in any way. They should be saving them from death or serious injury.
I don't understand why you would have to wait until someone died before entering the cafe. I just don't understand why they wouldn't have a plan in place, or their management wouldn't have a plan in place before that moment to say, hey, we're going to go in at this time on our terms.
I can't forgive people for that trigger. It's, I'll never be able to understand how you can decide, make a calculated decision that you wait for someone to die. It's just beyond me.
Inside the cafe, Monis had already singled out Tori Johnson.
He was sitting down. One of the tables away from the rest of us, by himself.
He referred to him as manager, and Tori actually being an authoritative figure within that space was undermining his authority in that room. So he did treat him with more contempt than he treated the rest of us.
He said, oh, when the police do break in, then when they do, you'll be the first one to die.
Police had set up a forward command post in the New South Wales Leagues Club behind the cafe. Tori's family was brought there during the morning.
I can just remember sitting there for hours. We didn't seem to have much information given to us at all.
You're very emotional and scared. You don't understand the situation. At that point inside the Leagues Club, we never received any information actually what was going on from the authorities.
At midday, Tori managed to send them a text from the cafe toilet. I'm hostage. I'm so scared. I love you all.
When he sent me that message to say he was a hostage and he was very scared, I asked one of the, you know, I said, went to the police and I said, can I answer him? And they said, no, you'd better not. And I just wish I had. Yeah, I will live with that forever.
Three hours into the siege, police commanders still didn't know who the hostage taker was. But Monis was well known to some police. Just before 12 p.m, detectives at Parramatta Police Station recognised Monis in the news footage. They knew exactly what he was capable of. Homicide detective Melanie Staples had investigated Monis for murder. Within minutes, Staples entered details of Monis's complex, violent history into the police system. Monis had been charged with orchestrating the murder of his ex-wife and 43 counts of sexual and indecent assault. The detective uploaded intelligence and psychological profiles describing Monis as a narcissist with extremist views, who had described himself as a terrorist. It would take more than 3 hours for the identification of Monis to reach siege commanders. Even then, some of the most significant details of his violent past didn't reach the forward command. For years, Monis had been a notorious figure, conducting political campaigns in public.
You've offended up. You've upset the entire country.
I do everything I do for the safety of all nations, including the nation of Australia, the nation of Afghanistan, and the nation of Iraq. All nations, we want peace. We don't want war. We don't want Australia to be unsafe.
The 50-year-old Iranian came here originally on a business visa, escaping fraud charges in Iran and leaving a wife and two children. He got a protection visa in Australia, and in 2004, ASIO cleared him for Australian citizenship. For his public campaigns, Monis had a helper and collaborator.
My name is Amira. I was born in Australia with a Greek background, and I was brought up Christian.
Amira Droudis, Monis' partner, had converted to Islam for him. Monis used her to push his ideas through videos posted on his website.
In the name of Allah, the most merciful and most beneficent. Welcome to... No, wait, come. No, I can't. I don't know what to say and I made a mistake. I can't... I need to know what I'm saying.
Okay, doesn't matter. Just... You can start again when you make a mistake. You can start again because you can edit it. Just, oh, this is for test. Just anything you like.
He made her read out letters he'd written to the families of Australian soldiers killed in Iraq and Afghanistan.
This is the message of the majority of the Australian nation for the troops that have invaded and occupied Iraq.
The letters that he wrote to the families of the deceased Australian servicemen who were serving in the Middle East, were he and Droudis, they were just disgusting.
In 2009, Monis was charged by federal police for sending offensive letters to veterans' families. He was released on bail. Assessed at the time by state and federal police and ASIO, there was collective agreement Monis did not pose a threat to national security. Amira Droudis, also charged for the letters crime, remained deeply in his thrall.
The illegal acts of our politicians has made our life unsafe. Australians will be attacked. Australians will be hurt. Australians will be killed. Australians will be killed. Australians will be killed. Allahu Akbar.
It was eerily prophetic. But the first Australian to be killed by Monis's madness was his ex-wife, the 30-year-old mother of his two youngest children. Monis's personal and political extremism had become entwined. On the 21st of April 2013, Monis's ex-wife, whom we can't identify, dropped off her children for a contact visit with Monis. He had a video camera running.
Is it open? Is it open?
After years of cruelty and violence towards her, Monis was now fighting to win custody of their children.
Is it open?
Daddy.
How are you? Very nice, very nice.
Monis had previously tried to hire a local bikie gang to kill his ex-wife. When that failed, he persuaded Amira Drudis to become a murderer.
Can Negar play soccer or basketball? Which one is better?
Soccer!
You need to hold my hand.
What?
Hold my hand, please. Thank you. He's close to the street.
Monis had organized an elaborate alibi for himself, a day out with friends.
Do you have the soccer ball?
He filmed his every movement. Starting at the park across the road.
Okay, can you please hold your hand past this here, please, cross with me? Come.
The softly spoken Monis played the concerned father.
Start, the video is on, start now. Okay. First we start soccer, basketball. Oh, look at this swimming pool.
After lunch, they moved further from the apartment to a local pool.
Oh, I can't see.
Okay, you all right? Is it okay now? Okay, slowly. Is it cold? After a while, then we'll be all right. When you are cold, let me know. You need to come out. Your towel is ready now.
Wow.
The children were due to be picked up at the apartment at 4.
Swim, the video is on.
As the hour approached, Monis recorded timestamps to prove he was far away from the scene of the crime.
No, I think your time is not exact because this is 10 minutes to 4. Is it? Yeah. 2 minutes, 1 minute is behind. Open the window.
As Monis got ready to leave the pool, in the stairwell of the apartment, his ex-wife walked into the trap he had set. Amira Drudis was waiting. Drudis stabbed the young woman 18 times, then poured petrol over her body and set her alight.
She was attacked, allegedly by another woman, in the stairwell.
Leaving his children with a friend, Monis drove past Penrith police station, where cameras filmed him swerving intentionally towards a police van. He feigned injury and was taken to Nepean Hospital, the final piece of his alibi. It was there that detectives came to interview him. Monis continued his performance.
I want to know why you are here.
Man, I'll inform you that your former partner is dead. She was involved in an accident in your unit complex earlier this afternoon.
Excuse me, my ex-partner?
Yes, that's correct.
What do you mean?
I'm afraid she's passed away. She's died earlier this afternoon.
Maybe someone else. Maybe it's someone else.
I'm afraid not.
When? Oh, what has happened?
That's what we're investigating at the moment. We're hoping that you could assist us with some information in regards to any of the aspects that would be surrounding what's happened to her.
Please feel free.
stop the recording.
The following day, the two children were at home with Monis.
Hello.
Hello.
With the woman who had just murdered their mother.
Delicious.
Good night.
Good night.
Are you
sleeping now?
We sleep early because tomorrow morning we want to go for breakfast to McDonald's. Okay, good night.
It's not a storybook, but it's a book with lots of interesting things.
Monis filmed the scene, purporting to show themselves as a happy family unit.
I'd love to do that.
Even referring to Drudis as Mummy. Yeah.
You want Mummy lay down here and read books for you?
Yeah.
If you have a story.
The children were later removed to live with their grandparents. But Monis and Drudis fought to regain custody, even as the murder investigation closed in. Digging into Monis's past, detectives uncovered a long history of sexual violence against women. Beginning in 2001, Monis had run a bogus spiritual healing practice in Sydney's western suburbs, using it to lure vulnerable women. Police discovered records of over 500 clients, some of whom went to a local lawyer for help.
I wouldn't say the names, but in some females, that they approached my office and they told me stories about his spiritual healings. I was told by them that he was first very gentle and really represented himself as a person to be trusted, as a professional, but later on, very soon, when they started the process of healing, they felt they were violated.
Detectives convinced seven women to make statements. They recounted harrowing details of Monis's sexual assaults and his threats of black magic. In November 2013, Monis and Drudis were arrested and charged with murder and accessory to murder, a joint criminal enterprise to kill his ex-wife. Amira Drudis was convicted of the murder last year and sentenced to 44 years in prison.
The day that he was arrested and charged, he was indignant, professing his love for Allah, and again that God is on his side and God would see things right for him because he was being victimised.
It was the justice system, not God, that helped Monis. Monis was denied bail and imprisoned in Silverwater, awaiting trial on the accessory to murder charges. He remained in jail for only a month before, astonishingly, being granted bail. Even his own lawyer was surprised. What advice did you give to Monis of his chances of success that day?
I told him that the prospects of success were not good.
You know, we just couldn't believe that two people who conspired to kill this guy's wife, she was stabbed and set on fire. You know, it was an absolutely vicious murder, that they could even consider that they wouldn't, that they'd be allowed bail.
Within months of being bailed, Monis was arrested again and charged with more than 40 counts of aggravated sexual and indecent assault. Again, he was bailed. The circumstances of Monis's release from jail are more evidence of the systemic failures that left this dangerous man free to go on his Lindt Cafe rampage. In a series of hearings, lawyers for the DPP misunderstood the nature of the murder charges against him and missed the crucial fact that the crimes had been committed when Monis was already on bail for sending the abusive letters. That fact alone would have made bail unlikely. Homicide and sex crimes detectives argued strongly for Monis to be returned to prison to await trial. But at the final hearing in October, just weeks before the siege, a solicitor for the DPP said police did not oppose bail.
The fact that the DPP didn't oppose bail was extraordinary. But what was even more extraordinary was they tried to have any consideration of bail excluded from the inquest. And so when a lot of the documents came in from the DPP, they were very heavily redacted, so we couldn't see them. Our legal counsel couldn't see them. You had people from the DPP in the witness box, not recall, I don't recall, I don't recall. I mean, it was just extraordinary.
The whole of Sydney feeling very nervous as this siege rolls into what is now getting on for 4.5 hours.
At 2 p.m, Police Commissioner Andrew Scipione made his first public appearance of the day.
We are at this stage continuing to secure and make sure that we're doing all we can to bring this to a peaceful outcome. We want this matter resolved peacefully, and we will do all we need to ensure that.
It was more than 2 hours since homicide detectives had identified Monis. But that information still hadn't reached the commanders.
At this stage, the operational advice I've got is that we're still determining what it is that, that may well be the motivation, and at this stage we are still not yet in a position to determine where the individual is from.
What communication have you had with this man so far?
Well, we're working through that, and at this stage we have not got extensive communications. In fact, we're not dealing direct with him.
ABC reception advice.
Hi, my name is Jared Morton Hoffman. I'm currently a hostage at Lindt Martin Place.
Monis refused to speak to police negotiators. Instead, he used the hostages to make his demands via the media.
What he wanted was for a major news outlet to say that this was an attack by the Islamic State on Australia, exactly what he told us in the cafe when he first took us hostage. And so he had us trying to call the ABC, trying to call SBS, Al Jazeera, Sydney Morning Herald.
Since the morning, hostages had been made to hold an Islamic flag at the cafe windows. Monis also demanded police deliver to him the flag of Islamic State.
I've been asked by the brother of the Islamic State that he is willing to exchange one hostage for a flag of the Islamic State if the media reports that this is an attack on Australia by the Islamic State, because the politicians are not telling the truth about the situation.
A month before the siege, Monis had pledged allegiance to Islamic State on his website. Just after the terrorist organisation had called for lone wolf attacks to be carried out across the world in their name, including in Australia.
He'd set up the possibility that he would go out a martyr and be declared as such by Islamic State, because he'd made it clear that his allegiance was with them. Clearly, in his mind, this branding was very important. I mean, this doesn't take away his own narcissism, his own psychopathic behaviour, but it tells us how he wanted to frame it.
In forming their strategy, senior commanders relied heavily on the opinions of a psychiatrist brought in to advise the negotiators. Like so many others at the inquest, his identity was suppressed. Did you get the sense that his views were influential?
I think they were very influential. They certainly influenced the negotiation cell, because he was supposed to be just an advisor to the negotiators. In fact, it seems that he was a lot more than that.
The main issue for me is that the psychiatrist, part of the negotiating team, he was quite unfamiliar with the subject of Islamic State.
By 3 p.m, Monis's identity was finally confirmed at Siege Command. In the first crucial teleconference about Monis at 3:35 p.m, the psychiatrist told commanders Monis was not a bona fide terrorist. Unaware of the recent call to arms by Islamic State, he asserted there were no signs of ISIS involvement or ISIS methodology. The psychiatrist said Monis was grandstanding Siege Commander Assistant Commissioner Mark Murdoch formed the view that Monis was bluffing and would not harm the hostages.
When the psychiatrist declared that Monis wasn't a terrorist, it just seemed like we were in the twilight zone, where we had the counter-terrorism unit in charge, and yet we had the psychiatrist declaring that the perpetrator wasn't a terrorist. I mean, what was going on?
In stark contrast to the commander's view, a report by the police intelligence unit circulated at the same time said Monis had a propensity for violence and the capability of injuring the hostages. By now, the hostages had been held captive for 6 hours.
I was on the window, just eyes closed, and I had Stefan and John on the couch, sort of on top of my right. They were talking, sort of in a low tone, but I could hear them, and I think so could Monis. He did warn him a few times, you know, stop talking, otherwise I'm gonna shoot you.
Three of the hostages decided to save themselves.
I was on the phone at the time in front of Monis, and I heard this loud crack, and I look up and I see John O'Brien has slammed the button on the front door.
Guys, there you go.
The next thing I saw was Stephen Balafutis going out through the front door.
Was it just coming out?
When I heard the noise and they were gone, and Monis was on his feet and everyone was...
Oh, I dived because I thought he was going to get up and shoot.
I could tell that people were ducking to the ground. I just froze on my chair.
Cafe worker Paolo Vassallo seized his chance.
Monis's attention is on that door. I didn't look at him, but I just turned my head a little bit and I could just hear the tables and chairs being dragged. And I'd made a run for it.
And I think that he's run through the front door, but actually it turns out he actually ran through the side door. So I thought all three of them ran out. Monis is freaking out and he starts saying the police have taken them, the police have broken in, the police are here.
I was sitting in the chair opposite my mother and he's on his feet and he just grabbed me by my shoulder effectively, had me up on my feet, holding onto the back of my dress from memory and, you know, it's managing me in front of him, you know, hanging on to me, holding me close. God, I was very close to him. And, you know, his gun is ready.
Jared Morton Hoffman stepped in.
And Jared's yelling, no, 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 they escaped. It's the police aren't coming, they escaped.
And he's saying, I'm going to have to shoot one of you now, I'm going to have to shoot one of you now. It's like he's almost G-ing himself up, like, I have to do this now. And so I just start talking and I just said to him, the police didn't break in, the police didn't break in, the police didn't break in, they just ran out, they just ran out.
You know, for his quick thinking, just to tell the truth about what actually happened, I think really saved my life.
Paolo ran into the tactical police.
I told them basically, what are you guys doing? He is going to shoot someone, not to wait for him to shoot first. He had no plan of coming out alive, so I wanted them to be the first ones to take action to give the people in there a chance.
One of the tactical officers, known as Officer B, claimed at the inquest, Paolo had told him there were wires sticking out of Monis's backpack, which would have been confirmation of a possible bomb.
Never came up in any conversation at all, believe me. I never saw any wires at any time, why they would bring this up and bring this up at the inquest. I had an interview with the police for many, many hours. If I had said that, why wasn't this passed on? Why wasn't this ever brought up? I've never mentioned any wires at any time in any conversation at all. It's simply not the case.
The three escaped hostages were taken to the Leagues Club to be debriefed by police. They said that Monis was acting in the name of Islamic State and that he'd told them he was prepared to kill.
And they should have used that as an opportunity to gather as much information of what was happening inside the cafe. And they didn't. They just simply didn't. And they didn't pass on the information. It kills me. It really does. And, yeah.
The psychiatrist listened in on the hostage debriefs. At the inquest, he said he didn't take Paolo's threat assessment seriously. He said Paolo was highly excited and he didn't listen to him terribly much because he was babbling.
For him to make all those accusations about myself is completely wrong. And maybe the police psychiatrist is upset because everything I said was spot on. I said, if you don't, not to wait, he will shoot. That's what will happen. Don't wait for this guy.
The remaining hostages were in no doubt that Moniz was now ready to kill.
And he goes, well, I'm going to make a deal with you now that if one person leaves, one person dies.
He was saying that if anyone else escapes, he will kill someone. He will kill someone for everyone that escapes. So this was a new thing that he was saying, and we all took that very seriously.
He was prepared to shoot someone, that's for sure. Absolutely, and he made that point very clear.
After the escapes, head of New South Wales counter-terrorism, Kath Byrne, gave a press conference.
We do have this situation in hand at the moment. We have our police negotiators on site. They are some of the best in the world, and we are very fortunate that we have these police dealing with the matter at the moment. And a peaceful resolution will be what we are working towards.
You talk about negotiators, does that mean that police have made contact with the gunmen or gunmen?
Police negotiators have had contact and they continue to have contact, and we will work through this as we do with our negotiators. It might take a bit of time, but we want to resolve this peacefully.
Byrne's statement was misleading. No direct negotiations ever took place during the entire siege.
He absolutely had no intention of speaking to the negotiators, and the negotiators were constantly trying to speak to him directly, but it was not going to happen. I felt at the time a sense that there was a lack of sophistication somehow.
Amongst the negotiating team, a view was taking hold, questioning Moniz's capacity for violence. A revealing conversation about the murder of his ex-wife was accidentally captured on a dictaphone. The lead negotiator, Peter, says he's not a violent man as such. He just likes a bit of power. The psychiatrist acknowledges danger exists, but asks, does he have the ticker for it? I don't think he does, a negotiator replies, because he got his missus to kill his other one. Peter says he doesn't do it. He gets someone else to do it.
The fact that he could get people to do his dirty work, I mean, that didn't say that he wasn't a violent man or he wasn't dangerous. It was perhaps more dangerous because, in a sense, he was able to get all these people to do these terrible things.
Just how much Moniz was misunderstood was brought home at the inquest, where the psychiatrist and the lead negotiator downplayed the violence of Moniz's sexual assaults. Peter argued there was no anger or weapons used. It was a passive sexual assault environment, he said. There's no violence there. The psychiatrist repeatedly described the sexual assaults of frightened women as acts of seduction. Hearing his testimony was one of the hardest days for the families.
That was probably one of the worst days of the inquest, actually, I think, for everyone in the court, hearing his evidence.
It was an affront. The psychiatrist doesn't even have an understanding of what violence against women is.
I just don't know how we can get to that place and start segmenting these sexual assaults into violent and non-violent, given what they were and given how they were perpetrated.
That is just outrageous, and it really puts everything else into context again. Who are we dealing with here from the police side of things, right? I mean, if what can we as the public say if there's anyone in the police force and their advisors that views these crimes as I don't know, not really crimes? I'm speechless.
At 6:30, Kath Byrne appeared again, expressing confidence in police strategy.
This is a very, very well-tested system of negotiation that we use. It is world-class, and it might take a little bit of time, but the safety of those people inside is what is paramount. We are in contact, and we will continue, and we will continue, and the aim is this peaceful resolution.
I was certain that it would end with violence. And Fiona and I had this conversation in the bathroom upstairs where she just stated to me directly, she was like, someone is going to die tonight. And I was like, I know. Because it was like, from our perspective, having spoken to him, having done his bidding, having watched him all day to see how he was acting, it was clear that it was not going to end with him just putting the gun down and just walking out in handcuffs. It was going to end with him having a one, you know, final stand against any intruder into the cafe.
Inside the Lindt Cafe, the increasingly erratic man Hieronymus was preparing himself for the inevitable last stand. He'd chosen this as the stage for his final performance. Innocent people would die as a consequence of his madness. But how big a role did police incompetence play in their deaths? Next week, the final countdown leading to the terrible conclusion of the Lindt siege.
I wanted to be there with him. You know, I just wanted to put my arms around him and just whatever was going to happen, I wanted to be there with him.
I knew he was in trouble. I knew he was in great danger.
In that moment, I think I screamed out, and I think I threw a chair or kicked over a chair or something. I still can't describe the anguish.